How the hell are you? Rockstar Dad here. I'm going to do something a little bit different today. Obviously, I lecture and I teach music to people. Somebody's asked, could I review or have a little reaction video to Better by Guns N' Roses? So what I thought I would do would be what we do with the students at the unis. Now, when you're teaching a performance assessment at a university, the first thing you have to do for the students is teach them what they're being assessed on, right? You have to have criteria. So what we do is we make up something called a rubric, a marking rubric. Now, I might post this at some point because if there's any music teachers watching this, I think it can be quite helpful. Can I just first say as well, before people start jumping down my neck, I think when you assess any kind of art form, that it is subjective. It's not thoroughly objective. It's not the same as a maths exam where you can say 2 and 2 equals 4 and you can't object, okay, to that, right? Some people can, some people would, right? But it's an absolute, whereas art is always someone's opinion. It's subjective. But with music performance, there are certain criteria that you can go through and mark. So, for example, the three main elements that I'm going to mark Guns N' Roses on. Now, I'm humbled, okay? I'm not doing this by going, I am better than Guns N' Roses. You know, I'm a big fan of Guns N' Roses. I love Guns N' Roses. The three main elements that I'm going to use, the first one is demonstration of musical arranging skills and creative part writing. So are you doing something creative? Are you using, are the parts that you've came up with for this song based on theoretical knowledge? Are they, and if they're not based on theoretical knowledge, are they based on some kind of skillful means that you can assess? The second one is appropriate presentation skills. Now, I think the word appropriate when you are looking at assessments is the biggest bag of shit word that you can use when you're putting that in criteria. What does appropriate mean? Appropriate to what? Appropriate to God? Appropriate to the next person? Appropriate can mean so many things, right? It's not a great word to use in criteria. It's one of those fluffy words that can mean anything, right? I'm sure lawyers like the word appropriate. Sorry, lawyers, I'm only joking. But appropriate's not a great word. The third one is your applied technical ability. Three things we're going to look at when we mark this video. We're going to look at your demonstration of your arranging skills and your part writing. We're going to look at the presentation skills and we're going to look at the technical ability as a band, as a unit. I'm not going to go through each individual and mark them. There's certain disciplines of instruments that I wouldn't feel 100% marking comfortably. For example, some of the more technical attributes of drumming. I couldn't mark certain things. I couldn't talk about some of the more technical attributes. I can talk about the production of drums and I can talk about, you know, how someone's performing. I'm going to mark them as a band. Now, this is how we do it at the universities with the performances. At some of the universities, there are 3 or 4 people marking a performance. So there'll be a stage there and the students will perform and the tutors will talk about a ballpark figure for the band. Now, that ballpark figure is from 0 to 100. 100 is the top mark you get, the top points or percentage, and 0 is the lowest. We talk about a ballpark figure for the band, so when you're giving each individual in the band their mark, they're not allowed to be more than 10 degrees out from each other, because if they're more than 10 degrees out, it takes away from this unit of an ensemble of a band. Everybody has got a role to play in a band that makes that band good, okay? I hope that's not too much information there, but yes, three main elements basically. I'm going to watch and comment on for the band. I'm going to give them a ballpark figure out of 100. Let's dive in. Guns N' Roses, Better, live at the Hard Rock, Las Vegas in 2014. We'll be right back. passing right straight away. Highly produced, very produced sound. Okay, let's pause it there for a second. Right, straight away, what you can look at if you're assessing the performance as a non-musician, so you don't even need to think of technicality, what do you see, okay? So the second criteria I'm going to focus on is presentation skills, okay? The first one, remember, was your creative part writing, the parts that you've written for the song, presentation skills and evidence of applied technical ability. But the second one, appropriate presentation skills, so far, visual interaction. Straight away, you've got the fireworks there that are going off at the start. Boom, you've got your audience enthralled in there. Everyone facing forward. The guitar player is very cool. I think this is this dude, Buckethead, that's on here, who's a great player, phenomenal guitarist, right? But he's playing with confidence, right? This is something that you can mark when you're watching a performance, is someone's confidence. How confident are they moving on the stage whilst they're playing music? How much do they know this thing called music that they are so confident, controlled, accurate? It's not just visual interaction, it's oral interaction as well. So you can talk about your presentation skills. You can even talk about things like guitar sounds and stuff. Now, so far, the sound is highly produced, right? You can hear all the instruments. All the parts have a certain position in the arrangement that they fill. The dynamic range is everybody's exploring the dynamic of the song. Everyone, when it's getting louder, everyone's getting louder. What's this flashing outside my window? See it flashing behind me? Maybe the aliens have landed. God knows, who cares, right? Yeah, so visual interaction. You can also talk about purpose and emotion. Now, I would say as far as purpose and emotional qualities go, body language, you can talk about that in a performance as well, okay? The guitarist's body language, he's strutting about that stage. Obviously, he owns it. He does own it. It's his gig. He's part of the band, right? Axel's going for a run now. There's a sense of occasion there, right? The audience are interested in it. There's a lot of movement going on. But always, the band are focused on that audience, you know? They're not turning away. The music is there for the audience. You're putting it across. So as far as appropriate presentation skills, appropriate, then I would say presentation skills, so far, we are marking high. Now, band-wise, when you get a degree, between a 0 and 40 is a fail. 40 to 50 is a third, you call it. Between 50 and 60 is a 2-2. Between 60 and 70 is a 2-1 class of degree. And then everything above 70 is a first-class degree. It's well above 70 already. When you're studying music at degree level, you're not even meant to be a professional. So I'm even marking this like this is kind of crazy. But there still are some elements we can look at here, right? Visually, it's got to be in the 90s, right? They've got the fireworks. Everyone is focused on, I mean, even what they're wearing. They've got the hats on. They've got what we always say to the students when you're starting out in music, accessorize. If you want to look like a rock star on the stage, get a hat, get a chain, get earrings, get something. Makeup, whatever the thing is, blokes can grow beards, girls can chuck the hair up or a little bit of both, you know, whatever you want to do. As far as looking like a band and you know, interacting with the audience. Lighting wise as well, there's a big full on light show there. That's 90s, right? Now, I will never give 100 for an assessment. It's impossible in my view, because it's impossible for art to be perfect, right? That's a kind of basic thing that I have, is that you can always make it better, right? You can always make art better. So you can't give 100 ever. That's just something that I go by when I assess performances. What about musical arranging skills and creative part writing? Again, I would score that in the 90s here, because what we're looking at is the music within the genre of rock, right? We're kind of in minor, natural minor. It's natural minor scale that we're talking about here. That's a trait of rock music, right? So you're going to communicate with fans of rock that are already out there. If you're using a scale that someone that's into metal or hard rock or whatever you want to call this associates with, then that's a demonstration of your skillful use of creativity and expression. I love this Buckethead dude's, his guitar sounds are great. His guitar sounds, he's got a whole bunch of different guitar sounds, right? Which is great. That's selling the dynamics of a song. Axel's voice on here for part writing, it's great. He's using his bottom end of the range and he's jumping up there. Now again, this is 2014, that top end of the range, he's not pushing, that's the thing. Everybody thinks, Axel, when you sing high stuff, you push really hard. You don't, as a vocalist, you know. You've got to go easy on the vocal cords when you're hitting higher notes and then put grit on afterwards, you know. Axel's voice, I would say, it could push a little bit more, this mix range, because there's one or two points there I can hear the head voice. It's a lot more head voice, and I want this pushed. But again, like I've said in other videos, if you're pushing that head voice into full mix all the time, every night for a big long tour, guess what? You're not going to be singing one night, as you can't belt all the time. You've got to learn control and just enough. Not too little, not too much, just enough. Because it can damage your vocal cords. Technical ability, I didn't hear one wrong note in there. Okay, technical ability, we can talk about stuff like rhythmic application, harmonic application, consistency, accuracy, control, the three C's I call it, coordination, control and confidence. Now, everyone is very confident with the parts that are playing there. One, you just have to look at a musician whose eyes are on the audience all the time. They don't even need to look at the guitar neck. They know what they're doing, it's controlled, okay? But it's also controlled to that level that everyone has a dynamic sense through the song of each other. Everyone can hear each other. I'm sure the monitor system is great. With this video, so far, I am going to give this as a ballpark figure. So some people in the band could get a 95, 96, maybe. Let's hear a little bit more. Let's put a little bit more of this track on. This tragedy that asks for our solution. This melody inside of me, there's a default solution. A twist of fate, the chain of heart, kills my infatuation. A broken heart, pulled by the spot, my determination. There, you can hear that grit. There, you can hear when he's putting the grit on there, and you can hear when he's not putting the grit on. Now, let's stop it there. So what is good with this performance that I love is that guitar player, the one at the front now, I don't know what his name is, but is that a double neck that he's playing there? I've not even been paying attention that much. I think it is. It's a very big body on that guitar. Can't see it that well. But what he's doing is he's improvising slightly with this. So he's feeling the moment on there. He's buzzing off the other players. He's taking some of the energy and he's taking his parts and he's embellishing them slightly, right? Maybe a little bit too much. You could say that it might be going a little bit over the top there, but the way it's mixed, you can't tell, you know? So, you know, with the mixing engineer, they're part of the band as well. I would say that, no, that's okay for that amount there. But Axel's voice, you can definitely hear it when he's focused on the notes and he's given enough grit, and you can tell them when it's just coming back to head voice, and you can just hear the bed voice. Yeah, double neck, there we go. It's all choreographed, okay? So they know when they're all walking forward, who's going to be where, so the lighting engineer knows when to shine the lights. So many young bands don't do this. They don't choreograph performances. Choreography? Nah. In a metal band, that's for Michael Jackson, moonwalking and all that stuff. No. Think about choreography. Think about your movement. Because one, if you've got lights on your show and you're not on that spot, guess what? There's a spotlight on nobody at that point, right? Here's the other thing. Even AC/DC use choreography. The rhythm guitar and the bass on the verses, they're always stood at the back, right? On the sing-along choruses, you see them walking forward and they sing on the mics, and once the chorus is over, they walk back. Guess what? That's choreography. Choreography is some kind of arranged movement. So think about that. That's great. That they would score more marks as well for the presentation skills when they've spent time on the choreography. Now, big bands like this spend time on the choreography before the big tours. They go in some big rehearsal place so that they can get the whole rig in there. The stage is set, the lights are set, and they can go through. You stand here in that solo, I'll go there. You jump over my head, I'll do a cartwheel here, you do that. And they do that every night. You know, you've got to do the same kind of thing every night with little bits of improvisation here and there. It's a show, right? People come to see a show. So, this type of gig, anyway, it's a show. Right, okie dokie, let's have another little listen. Oh, there we go. Lovely bit of tapping there. Right now, he's scoring high now on this technical ability, because timing, control, confidence with a part like that in front of a big arena, whilst the energy's going, just to calm yourself down, play a run like that, it's not that easy, right? So he's getting bonus points right there. That's some brilliant playing there. Maybe that's Buckethead. I don't know who Buckethead is, because Buckethead's always got bucket on his head, right? You can help me out with this stuff, guys, right? Guns N' Roses is a band I grew up with Appetite, with Use Your Illusion, with Lies. And then I've not really paid that much attention to Guns N' Roses since they all split up. So maybe you guys can help me out with that stuff. I'm sure that's Buckethead there with the red guitar. It's almost a bucket in his head. Oh, wow. The guitar poses, choreography again. That's what you pay your money to see Axel do. About a 6-4 there. 6-8. 6-4. Look at three guitarists. Nice playing. Lovely playing. They get the projections behind. Oh, and now he's up on the ceiling. Very Slash-esque. Legato. Sounds like you can sing that boy as well. Give him a verse actually. Big rock poses. I mean, look at the stage, how it's lit, the floor lit. Big production. Brilliant. Did you see the camera go out there? The you get the drummer on the hats and it's on the offbeat he's hitting. I was going, is he playing in the offbeat? No, I think whoever's edited the video just put that in. Okay, ballpark figure. Main elements, demonstration of musical arranging skills and creative part writing. Now, I'm kind of taking it that those guys have written those parts. I'm sure some of those guys are just playing session on this gig. I'm just going to take it that they're the parts. The parts are brilliant. The parts are definitely first class. Ballpark figure for the band. What's the highest I would like to give? I would say the guitarist, because of all the tapping and the different techniques he's using and the control, the rhythmic control, the sound effects that he's using. I can't remember what you call the wee button on the guitar, a dead stopper or something that cuts out your pickups. You know, when you switch, you can turn the volume down on your pickup and then go between the pickups and it cuts it out. What's it called? A dead stopper? Can't remember the name of it. His creativity with the guitar, his control of the parts, his interaction with the audience. He's also singing. Get extra marks for that. You know, if you're showing that you, as a musician, you have control over more than one instrument, maybe bonus mark. So I would maybe want to give that dude a 95, 96, 97. Everybody's done their job well, that's the thing. It's not about always being flash on a music exam. If you play something simply well, that should get you a high mark. You don't need to show off, right? Look at B.B. King playing one note. You don't need to play 500 notes. And it also depends on the genre of music, right? So, yeah, let's score that. Guns N' Roses, better. Let's go with ballpark. Because we can go up to 95, right? And we can go down to 85. Would we want to go down to 85?
3, 2, 1!
Right, I'm going to go with 90. I'm going to go with 90 for this performance, right? I think just because maybe I would want to see some more people in the band doing little improvisational fluctuations in their parts, you know, some little bits of articulation in there. I think that possibly could have gained them more marks in there. Maybe a bit more interaction with each other as a band. I might want to see them getting a bit more excited with. I know Axel walks out with a guitar player at one point, but a little bit more energy, I think we could have got out of there with a little bit more band interaction. Perhaps, okay? Perhaps. So, there you go. Better, Guns N' Roses, live at the Hard Rock, Las Vegas, 2014. I'm going to do some more of these videos because I enjoyed talking about this and talking about the stuff we kind of teach at the unis, because I think it might be helpful as well for any of you guys that are studying music to actually get a little bit of information as to what your tutor might be looking at when you're performing, you know. I'll see you in the next one. Take it easy. Peace. Yeah.